let's talk to people a little bit about the basics of the book. So describe the book that you've written, which looks a lot like this.
Yep.
Props. What does it come with, props?
The basis of the book is, we wanted to write the book for giving tools to entrepreneurs to really monetize innovation. I think pricing and monetization is probably one of the most uncomfortable topics for entrepreneurs. How do you actually price something that you came up with, kind of thing, right? And the premise of the book is that companies that actually start thinking about monetization from the get-go, when they have an idea and kind of build around that information, are far more successful than companies that just build products and they're like ready to launch into the market and oops, you hear a price, slap something and launch into the market, hope for the best. We wanted to switch that hope and help companies know that they would monetize.
So one of the things that's interesting to me about that is if you think about, so you give an example in the book talking about two car companies that are designing new models. One is a Porsche, and one is a Dodge. One of them did it better than the other. Can you talk a little bit about that, and then I'm going to follow up.
Yeah, absolutely. So the tale of two cars is super interesting to us because it represents two ways innovations are monetized. The first way, when Porsche in the 90s, they were going through like kind of challenges like any company, they wanted to do something different. They wanted to innovate. And they came up with this idea that they would do an SUV. An SUV for Porsche kind of didn't make sense. I mean, like SUV for a Porsche, where they're known for 911s and like the sports cars. What they did was fascinating. Before they built any of an SUV, even before they drew up a sketch, they went and validated with the market whether there is, there's potential for an SUV. And what they did after that was way more fascinating. Every feature that went into the SUV, they validated with their customers and prospects whether people needed it, whether people valued it, and more importantly, were people willing to pay for it. So things like a 6-speed manual transmission, which people didn't need, but was the best thing that Porsche was used to doing, was out of the window because people didn't need it and they wouldn't pay for it in an SUV. A big cup holder goes against the grain of most German engineers, was in because people were willing to pay for it. On and on it went, and they designed the product around this information, or around the price, like we like to call it in the book. The other part of the story is Dodge Dart. Which followed probably a more classic way of bringing products to market, which is design it, build it, destroy it, tweak it, perfect it. And perfection was defined by the engineers. And when it was time to like launch the product, slap on a price, put it in the market, and hope for the best. The biggest challenge with that whole kind of innovation, and I think it was documented even in Market Watch and others, that Dodge Dart was probably missed the boat on what people actually needed. They had way different features, but the biggest thing they missed was they didn't have the willingness to pay conversations with people around what they were actually developing. It was called the second biggest flop of that year. The first one was Apple Maps, so it was a bit of Apple Maps bad in some ways.
So
for that matter, one of the biggest successes in automotive industry, 50% of profit today for Porsche comes from the
SUVs.
Yeah.
So, mission happened. Let's talk about that for a second. So, Steve Jobs famously took a point of view that people didn't know what they wanted to buy, that they didn't need to do that kind of research, that until he made it, people didn't know that they wanted it.
Yep.
That's the example. That's the basic idea. So what you're proposing, though, is something that takes the opposite point of view. So, how do you think about that?
Everyone loves Steve Jobs, including myself, and me in some ways. So let me characterize this way. I think Steve Jobs was both a product visionary and a pricing visionary. Most people think of Steve Jobs as just a product visionary. And it's a bit of like build it and they would come kind of mentality. We love exceptions as a society. We talk about the Henry Ford and Steve Jobs, not the 98 people who actually had the opposite outcome, right? We want to write a book for like the other 98 to maximize their odds for like success. And of course, we the Steve Jobs and others in that process. the thing with like with Steve and just pricing about Apple, I mean, when they started, they had like a classic streaming strategy, they had segmentation strategy, they had a whole portfolio strategy around how they would actually monetize to become one of the largest profitable company in the world. I think people miss that fact that there was a monetization strategy behind a product that they actually built, not just a product. And I mean, if Steve had launched an Apple phone at $99 like any other company, I think that would, would have been a bit of history.
So, can we talk a little bit about the difference between pricing a product like a new car, where there's some clear parameters around the car? You know, you need to have certain features, you have certain expectations on manufacturing, there are safety features, all set of things that go into car pricing. And also, there's a long history of consumer experience about what they might be willing to pay for a car. In the valley, sometimes you're dealing with products where there are not good precedents. One that we talked about a little bit together outside is the Segway. Right? So if you think about Segway, no one had experience, no one had previously bought a Segway or anything that looked like a Segway. And so if you were to go to consumers and say, what would you pay for this?
Yeah.
Or describe it to them and say, what would you pay for this?
Yeah.
Can you get good information? And talk about how that played out also with
the So what we really prescribed in the book is introducing willingness to pay and pricing conversations earlier on. Right? I mean, if you think about most companies here, even in Silicon Valley, would say we do product market fit and we try to build products for the right market. I mean, say, do you like this mic? I might say, yeah, do you like this mic at $200? The whole conversation is different, right? I mean, unless you put pricing as part of your product market fit validation, you're often hearing what you want to hear. So when you actually validate an idea, even putting a price point and saying, hey, if you actually build this innovation and you like it, yeah, would you like it if it was around, if you priced it around X dollars, what do you think? You would actually hear a lot of information earlier on from your customers because they're not in a negotiation mindset. They're giving you more objective feedback. You describe what you're actually building and say, Segway, could you pay $5,000 for this? People will be like, no chance. I mean, because people already have a perception of what the other alternatives are in terms of transporting themselves from A to B and have a certain value and price in their mental models, and you're tapping into it. So like kind of prototyping earlier on, having those conversations around would people actually pay for it, will lead you to a better product market fit. And I mean, if they had known that, probably they wouldn't have just developed a product and launched it at an exorbitant price in some ways.
People are doing it in nature, are always talking about trying to solve problems, solve, meet people's pain points, those kinds of things. But what you're suggesting, in fact, is it's not enough to meet their, solve their pain point, but you solve their pain point at a price that they can.
You need to solve their pain points in such a way that you make things sustainable for yourself, so you'll actually solve more pain points in the future. Many companies here, especially in the Valley, probably are so growth focused, don't understand monetization necessarily, and build products and launch it in the market and hope for the best. And we talk about it, 72% of products that were released didn't meet their revenue profit targets, so simply failed. And that's staggering. I mean, that's not just us saying, probably people say 2 in 10 startups actually fail. Failure is not necessary for success. That's probably the common belief, but what we really say is, it's about failing smart and looking before you leap. As an entrepreneur, you don't have a choice whether you have a pricing conversation with your customer. The only thing that is in your control is when you would have it. If you have it, let's say, 6 months before you launch your products and figure out if people are willing to pay for this, you probably design things around what you're hearing. If you do it after the fact, you're just hoping for the best.
So in the book you talk about how sort of the typical innovation cycle,
yeah,
product development cycle, as that you find most commonly, actually is not the one that you recommend.
Yeah.
So talk about what people do,
yeah,
and then what you think they should do.
Yeah, so the typical innovation process is design it, build it, price it, and then sort of sell it. What we actually talk about is price it or market it first, price it, then design it, build it and then sort of sell it. It's a bit of like moving pricing to the R&D stages of a conversation, not like an afterthought after you build something and all you can do is like slap a price and hope for the best. Right? That's the big difference. The reason why companies that actually do what we prescribe, the reason they're really successful is because they get these early indications of whether their product is going to be successful. They get an early indication of whether people are willing to pay and often design their product around that information because then they can prioritize, you know, what people are willing to pay for and then focus their development efforts on those. We write about a classic example in the book where a two-sided marketplace company just probably around the corner, they came up with like 100 different features, classic brainstorming, went out, 1,000 post-it notes, 100 features, and they came and told the CEO, we're going to build it, and 25 of these. Why? And the CEO asked the team, how do you know people actually pay for this? Finger of silence. They went and validated stuff, and they actually figured out that only eight features that they were building really moved the needle. And so what they actually did was prioritize those eight, build a kick-ass UI, you know, UX experience around it, and build stuff that actually is sustainable that they could launch in the market to actually monetize. Right? So rather than dilute the whole thing and build a feature shop.
So a couple of thoughts about that. So what you're saying in a way is that it's not just about getting the price right in advance, but it sounds like what you're saying is that people tend to overload the typical, let's say, technology product in this case, with features that people don't want to pay for.
Yeah, that's a typical way many of these technology products actually fail. I mean, I think we also have a level set on what price means, first of all, right? I mean, for many people, when we say price, they think of a dollar figure. That's a price point. When we talk about price, it's a measure. It's like liter is a measure of volume. Price is a measure of value. If you look at that ways, pricing or price is an indication of whether customers want your product and to what extent they actually want it. And one of the typical ways companies actually under-monetize or like even fail is to like load things with so many features, and we call that a feature shock, and at the end of the day it doesn't resonate with anyone because there's too much going on. Right? The alternative for that entrepreneur would have been to probably do different versions and aim it at different customer segments, but in a haste of putting everything into a one-size-fits-all, they probably made a one-size-fits-none.
So one thing that this discussion brings to mind, right, is that there are many cases in the Valley, particularly in the internet space,
yep,
where people take the point of view that we're going to roll out a product, we're going to collect an audience, and then we're going to figure out a monetization strategy eventually. Yep. And you can think of even some very widely used services online with tens or hundreds of millions of users where this was the strategy, we're going to collect lots of eyeballs, and if we just collect them all, there's going to be some way to get people to pay for that.
Yeah. The successful companies that have done this actually have that way figured out much earlier, and they plan for that strategy over a period of time. The ones that just purely go for growth and have no clue on how to monetize continue to struggle today, and they have probably no clear indication of how they can actually go there, and probably they just have growth in some ways. They're even the farm away in their free products, and they just can't get themselves to build a paid product because their free product is just too awesome. Right, I mean, so the ones that actually did this well have a clear strategy of like what to productize so that you can monetize in the future.
It's interesting because the other element of this, right, is that the stereotype of a Silicon Valley inventor is some wild genius who has a brainstorm of an idea. Has a genius idea, we're going to invent this amazing thing, and if all goes well, we're going to get rich.
Yeah.
But the how they're going to get rich part doesn't necessarily come into the first conversation.
Absolutely. I mean, a company that actually did this really well, LinkedIn, if you look at them, they're two-sided marketplace, and when they started, they were charging more on the recruiting side of the business, so like for people to get access to, like, you know, recruiters to get access to people like us. If you fast forward today, 20% of their bottom line actually comes from, you know, consumers who are actually paying for like premium subscriptions to see things like, you know, who looked at my profile, send emails, etc. That's a conscious strategy of actually shifting, you know, monetization for a period of time. Without having a monetization strategy, you probably never monetize, you're just hoping. And when we talk about monetizing here, we're not talking about just when you launch the product. It's typically a customer lifetime value and it's a relationship. That's kind of what we talk about in the book. growth is not a bad thing. We actually know how you're going to. It's not hopeful.
Okay.